Yusuke?
Yeah, I'm
a student from Japan.
Oh.
To the school?
Yeah.
Yusuke, I'm a
Hi, I'm Tyler Godat. I'm a graduate student at the University of Rochester. I'm a PhD candidate in the Institute of Optics. This is going on my fourth year now, and I do biomedical optics research in retinal imaging. Each of the individual ganglion cells that we're able to see has a neural connection to different types of cones in the eye. There are three different types of cones. There are, we'll just say, long, medium, and short wavelength cones. The long ones are really good at seeing red light, the medium ones are really good at seeing green light, and the short wavelength ones are really good at seeing blue light. And so near the fovea, there's almost a one-to-one connection of one cone connects to one ganglion cell. So if we play different stimuli of different colors, of different patterns and things like that, then we should see that each ganglion cell responds to a particular color the best. And so there's all these specializations of each cell might respond really well to red and green light, it might respond really well to red and blue light, it might respond really well to fast moving temporal frequencies, it might respond really well to slow moving but really fine detail, high spatial frequencies. And categorizing that in the fovea at the very center of your eye is something that has never been done before. And so there's even the small but distinct possibility that we might find a cell that has unique capabilities or a unique function that's never been seen in elsewhere in the eye or by anyone else before.
It's Andrew Berger. I am a professor of optics here in the Institute of Optics, the University of Rochester. I also have an appointment in the biomedical engineering program. And I've been at the university since 2000.
This is a project where we were measuring blood flow in the heads of babies. So it's the other side of what you were just seeing in the other lab where you can look into someone's retina and get information. So here we placed a headpiece like this. It's got a bunch of optical fibers, and babies were wearing this headpiece. So some of the optical fibers were on their forehead, and some of them were on the back of their head. And you can actually, by placing these optical fibers on the back of someone's head, you can actually measure their blood flow when they. What we do is on this screen, we would flash. A flashing picture. And when you see a flashing picture on a screen, it stimulates your visual part of your brain. And so it starts to process and work harder. So it needs more blood. And so literally you shine light into the back of someone's head and you can see that there's more blood there. It's kind of like the thing they clip onto your finger in the hospital to measure your blood oxygen. They are checking to make sure that your heart is providing oxygen to your blood, and so they measure something out here. But we're doing that, measuring it instead of in your finger, we're measuring the blood in your brain. And you might think, hey, I have a skull. You can't get light through the skull into your brain, but you can. Mm. Not that much, but you can get enough. So this is a project that we spent for many years. We were doing this on babies, so we have all these toys and things. Yeah. We had a song that was playing. The baby would sit on this chair and look at the screen and try to be calm. So, and but it's actually a pretty sophisticated piece of work.
Hi, my name's Jim Mitchell, and I am a staff member for UR Nano.
So what goes on?
All right, so this is the UR Nano clean room. And in this facility, we have physics students, biomedical engineering students, optics students, and engineering students in general build devices that they can't make anywhere else as part of their research.
Hey,
is a two-dimensional material station. We make graphene here, we make hexagonal boron nitride here, but it's basically materials that are one atomic layer thick at a time. And students come in here and make these things as part of their research experiments. So the reason we got gowned up, the dust out there is about 100,000 particles in a cubic foot. In there, on most weeks, we're around 100. That's why we had to put on the clothes that we wore. That machine there is worth more than $1 million. As set up, I think roughly $1.5 million.
The Institute of Optics here actually developed this originally during the Second World War. Yeah. These were used to mark runways. Mm-hmm. So if you have a pilot coming in and you only want the pilot to see where the runway is, you can't just put lights because then it says, oh, look, there's a runway. But you put these along the runway and then the plane shines a light. And because of the way this is designed, no matter what direction the light comes in, it goes back along the same line. So a pilot coming in shines a light, and only the pilot sees the light shine back. So this was developed for the war effort, but then during the space race, we put these on the moon. And in fact, the company that made the ones that are on the moon is based out in California. We've got one of our alumni works there now, and they're still making precision optics. But the reason we know that the moon is very slowly drifting away from the Earth at about 1 centimeter per year is that we've got these on the moon, and we just keep a laser on it and monitor the light that comes back. So there are a bunch of these up on the lunar surface. Cool. So there's, for someone who's interested in space, there is a fair... Aha, to make wind.
Yeah,
I understand.
Make wind,
fan. A fan. That's, that's great. Thank you. That's really cool. Thank you so much.
Yeah, and this is a Japanese snack. And this is...
Japanese snack.
Yeah, Japanese cake.
Oh, we should have... You know what I like. Great. Well, thank you so much. A little bit of Japan here in my office makes me very happy. Very happy. Thank you. I hope you had a great trip.
Okay.
And I hope you continue to have a great trip.
Yeah.
And you're meeting with Jaime Cardenas.
Correct.
Great. Jaime is wonderful. I think you'll have a great time with him. Thank you for coming.
Yeah. Thank you for everything. I very good. I'm very. Enjoying the tour, trip of America, and I want to come here.
We'll be waiting.
Yeah.
We'll be waiting for you to come back. So, and tell your friends.
Okay.
So, good. Thanks for coming along.
I really appreciate you.
Good to meet you. Thank you, Tyler. Really.
This is all you, man. Thank you so much.
You know what I did? I said yes, and then all of this happened. That was the easy bit. Thanks for coming, and safe travels.
Thank you.
Yeah. And good luck with the sleep.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
My name is Juniali Norial. I am a second year PhD student at the Cardenas Lab of Integrated Photonics. My work is in how to scale photonics for everybody's use so that it can be available in the market. And I'm a PhD student here. So as I told you, we are making these chips which use light instead of electricity. So you can see how this is a small chip. Do you see this small thing?
Yes.
See the laser light? Right
there? Like UV light or just light in general?
This is a laser, so this is a red light. It's a visible light. For communication, we use the telecom wavelength light, which is 1550. It's near IR, so you don't see it. It has its own applications, but you can use visible or whatever you want. So here the light is going in. As you can see, in the fiber you would not see it unless you bend it somewhere. So if you bend it, the light starts to leak out. So then you can see if there's a breakage or something.
Can I speak? What? How much was that?
That was like 5 seconds. 5% of 40 watts.
So you said it was just only 5% of this of, what
yes.
this machine is
yes.
capable of?
Sorry, no, 45 watts?
Yeah. Ooh, smells so bad.
Laser, which we just used to burn the paper, it can melt glass in about 35 milliseconds.
Milliseconds?
Yes.
Not the second.
No. 35 milliseconds. Yes, that's correct. Looking at integrated photonics, that's the new electronics. You have electrical circuits in your phone, or your computers have these motherboards, complex designs and structures. They all use wires which send in electricity, the ones in your regular power supplies. But what we are trying to do is replace electricity with light, and light is lasers, so you send light into these instead of electricity. So yeah, now you have, instead of wires, waveguides, and these waveguides are like the optical fibers which help in transmitting all these information and data. So it would be more faster because you're using light, not electricity, and because it's light, you would not have any thermal losses. So if you have a phone which is made up of a photonic chip, it would never heat up because there's no heat losses. So it's like a perfect plan for the future. Patterns there.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the chip. Whoa.
So, Isuke and she just gave it to you.
Where is it? Wow.
Whoa.
僕の名前は Isuke で、僕は今、航空宇宙工学科っていうところで、人工衛星について学んでいます。アメリカに来てすごく感じたことは、みんなフレンドリー でとてもなんか話しやすい雰囲気があって、とても刺激的な1週間になりました。でやっぱり大学とかキャンパスツアーして、なんか僕が学んでないことをいろいろ学んで、なんかこんなこと、先進的なことをやってたり、すごい機会があったり、やっぱすごい国だなって、まあ、一言でまとめると、まあ、すごい国だったなって個人的には感じました。
Hey guys, as you know, I'm an undergraduate at the Institute of Optics. If you have any questions about the school, or maybe about applying there, or even the stuff you saw in the video right now, just send me a message on Instagram or email me, and I'll be happy to talk to you, okay? Thank you for watching.